was amused when I looked at this slide by the fact that, you know, here's a little test, which is actually only about 1% of the size of, at least the volume of the missions on either side. It's about this high, and it's about this big, and it weighs about 350 kilograms. So hopefully, you know, good things come in small packages, and that's what I'd like to share with you today. But the basic idea is that it really is intended to bridge the period of time from Kepler to JWST, and there are many ways in which the mission has been optimized so that it will actually act as a finder for interesting objects in the second and third solicitations for JWST targets. Specifically, the mission goals from the beginning have been that we would carry out a large area survey of bright stars. And the key idea, going back to when we first started working on TESS now a decade ago, was that we would really look for the very best candidate to do exoplanet discovery work for. And these would include sun-like stars, as well as M dwarfs that are known within 200 light years. And in order to do this, one of the things that's key is that you have to design a mission that has a very high Etendu. And since we couldn't have a collection of mirrors that were meter class, what we actually opted to do, and I'll come back to this question of Etendu in a few minutes, is we elected to emphasize the omega part instead of the A part of the Etendu relationship. In addition to exoplanets, these are some of the topics related to time domain astrophysics that TESS will be able to address, ranging from objects in the solar system all the way out to extragalactic sources. And a large number of these investigations are made practical by the fact that TESS has such a large field of view, and it has a very high data rate, which will allow us to bring down full frame images at the same cadence that TESS was able to do. I'm sorry, that Kepler was able to do. So in terms of the actual precision that the mission has, this is a plot that actually shows, as a function of apparent magnitude, the uncertainty in parts per million per square root of hours that the mission would be able to accomplish. And the different curves that are indicated here are the contributions of various portions of the noise budget that we've actually had to work with. And so for small exoplanet transits, we're going to be working in this range, primarily with bright sources, with bright stars. And then for other areas within astrophysics that for which time domain astrophysics would be the key focus, whether they be stars or whether they be galaxies or active galactic nuclei or whatever, this entire range out here is actually available for the mission because of the ability to bring down the full frame images. The passband that TESS has been optimized to work in is shown here. This is wavelength along this axis and spectral response along the y-axis. And the cut-on at 590 nanometers is determined by an interference filter. And then we go all the way out to about a micron, which is dedicated by the properties that the deep completion CCDs have that will allow us to cover almost an octave in the passband. There are four cameras associated with the mission, and they're arranged in this skewed pattern. And the ensemble of these four cameras covers 24 degrees by 24 degrees, and there are four of them all together. So the actual ensemble is 24 degrees by 96 degrees. So TESS instantaneously will view about 2,300 square degrees of the sky in a single shot. Coming back to this concept of Etendu and the comparison with Kepler as a standard, some people who were here on Wednesday may recall that I commented that TESS was a quarter the Etendu of Kepler. Ben Chappie actually pointed out that I had that wrong because there's another factor that comes in, which is the number of pixels that's your telemeter compared to the number of pixels in the focal plane. So if you actually go through this more carefully and do the calculation based on the value of A, which I did get right, and the value of omega gross, which I also got right, but then this number was the one that I had wrong, and if you go through that calculation, then the Eton Newton test is about 5 times greater than the calculation for the 30-minute cadence. So that really, before it was comparable, and that this made me realize that it's actually a little bit better than what people thought. So anyway, the other thing about thinking about how tests will actually be able to carry out its survey is shown in this animation that I'm going to show in a minute. What you're going to see, this is a projection down onto the basically the plane of the ecliptic, and the numbers going around here are right ascension, and the dots that you're going to see as the animation proceeds will correspond to which objects are either known from Kepler, predicted for tests, or objects that were obtained from non-Kepler searches. And if they're really a great object that's potentially habitable, they'll be shown by a 5-pronged star. Now this is an animation, but the actual distances for the Kepler objects are in fact correct. So if I let this run, hope this will run. Okay. All right, here we go. Okay. Now, as you go further out in distance, this is, we're out at 3 parsecs from the S is the sun, center of the animation. Then it looks like we can expect to find an object that corresponds to a temperature that would in fact be in the habitable zone and comparably in size to the Earth itself. So, and based on some of the projections that have been made and some of the observations that have been made on the ground, these are probably realistic estimates to go with. So if you go a little bit further out, at 10 parsecs, you start to see a few more planets come in. And at 30 parsecs, which is where that's really an optimum radius for many of the objects that we're going to be looking at, you can see it's very heavily populated by these orange dots. And then if I just let this run a little bit further, then you'll see what happens, even out to 200 parsecs or so. And this spray of black gray dots that you see coming into this range are the cone of the sky that Kepler views. And then if I run further out, and you see how the enormous number of Kepler objects that dominate this segment of the animation out here. Okay, so the next thing that we've done recently, and this is being redone with the candidate target list for tests, is to simulate how the objects will be distributed around the sky, both in terms of the ones that are for pre-selected stars, which are the red dots, and those that would be detectable planets around the 20 million stars that are going to be present in full frame images. And that's what these little blue dots are that are scattered all around. And you can see that this is an ecliptic coordinate, so in the north and south of the pole, there are these concentration of objects. So, and then for scale, there's the Kepler field. The other thing that I'd like to show is just an animation. If TESS really does launch in March as planned, what will we actually see in the first 3.5 months of observation in terms of what the satellite is actually doing? So this is greatly sped up. If you see this little blurry dot right here, that's the Earth spinning frantically, and this is the Moon, and the TESS is going around. And then once in orbit, it makes an adjustment where it snaps about 26 degrees in ecliptic longitude, and then looks to a new portion of the sky. So it continues to do this during the entire 2-year baseline primary mission. So then when the survey is underway, we're looking at these strips. There are 13 in each hemisphere. That extend from near the ecliptic up to the ecliptic pole. It's so they're 24 degrees wide by 96 degrees high. And then at the completion of the survey, we end up with a region that has exposures of almost a year in the poles, and the region that's shown in this black line are actually those portions of the celestial hemisphere, one in the north and one in the south, that are observable by JWST for more than 200 days per year. One of the things that's caused us to have to delay our launch has been the availability of our launch vehicle. It looks like that's getting sorted out. It's a Falcon 9. They had a launch this morning, if anyone was paying any attention. There's one more this weekend. This is important for us because there's a queue of 23 additional flights that we're going to have to wait for, and it's likely that we will be flying on an advanced model of this rocket called the Block 5, which is still undergoing certification. The timeline for the mission is what I'm showing here. This is where we are right now, and this indicates that the cameras are being delivered. Half of them were delivered this week, and the other two are coming next week. And then the launch is here, and then we observe the southern ecliptic hemisphere starting in March, and then we continue on in the second year to do the northern ecliptic hemisphere, and hopefully we'll get the go-ahead for an extended mission in the 2019 timeframe. If there is an extended mission, these are some of the ideas that we've thought about. This is a white paper that Luke Buma has been preparing for a variety of ways in which the fields of view of the cameras can be arrayed around the globe to provide additional coverage, either at the poles or in the hemisphere, or do an ecliptic survey like was the case for K2. So these are the takeaways I'd like to leave you with in the mission. It's really focused on nearby bright stars for the primary science. But because of the capability that the full-frame images bring to the mission, we should be able to do a lot of astrophysics in areas that are not necessarily related to exoplanets. And the capability of the instrument, I didn't talk about this, is such that it could, in principle, operate for more than two decades. And hopefully the planets that Hess discovers, as have been the case for those that Kepler has discovered, will be the very best small planets for future observations for the community as the new missions that we heard Eric talk about are going to come to fruition. So thank you.
Thank you.